Reason and Religion, a philosophy talk bundle.
Can an intelligent, reflective, scientifically literate person in the 21st century still believe in God?
Or has the advance of science undermined the very possibility of faith and religious belief?
Are there ways for reason and faith to peacefully coexist or even to complement each other?
We invited some of the world's top philosophers to discuss the importance of reason, the value of religion, and their connections to truth, goodness, and God.
Coming up, has science replaced religion? Has science conquered all the territory for reasonable belief? Must a thinking person reject all religion? Or can science and religion be reconciled?
Is it possible that the pursuit of scientific understanding might even enhance religious faith?
In this episode, we put those questions and more to cosmologist George Ellis, winner of the 2004 Templeton Prize.
Welcome to Philosophy Talk, the program that questions everything.
Well, except your intelligence. I'm Ken Taylor.
And I'm John Perry.
We're coming to you from the studios of KALW Radio in San Francisco, but you know, we like to imagine ourselves down in Stanford Corner, sitting underneath the veranda in Philosophy Corner there.
Today we're going to examine two things, science and religion and their relationship. Are these two ways of explaining the same thing, Ken?
Oh, well, I mean, I think science is a way of explaining things and, you know, potentially everything. I'm kind of a scientistic guy, I have to admit. And religion, well, I don't know what business it's in, but I don't think it has much explanatory work to do, John.
So you just one of these young guys that thinks that science is going to explain everything, and that'll be that.
Well, I'm not so young anymore. What I am is a post-Darwinian, I think, and a thoroughly modern guy. I mean, there was a time when you could have believed that. Like the design argument for the existence of God was a good explanation of why there are people and animals with all these complexes.
Well,
but I don't think anybody post-Darwinian can believe that anymore.
Let's stop a minute and talk about what the design argument is, or I should say the design arguments. There's a very old argument, and I would guess it's the argument for the existence of God that has won the most adherence to religion.
I think that's probably right.
And that's the idea that if you look around the world and you see all the complexity and the way that things seem to be designed for each other, fruit trees seem to be designed for people to eat. We are incredibly more complex than the most complicated machine, and no one would ever come across a machine and say, oh, that just happened. So that argument, the classic design argument, is the one to which you refer.
Yeah, but I think Darwin explains that capacity without explain that complexity without positing an intelligent designer. So I just,
what do you mean positing?
You know, without supposing that
supposing,
there is.
Supposing, yeah. Why use a $5
word?
Yeah,
you're referring to some other design argument.
Well, there's an argument that says, okay, I'll give you that, but evolution itself, the possibility of evolution, the possibility of a universe, anything like the one we have that could support life, depends on the fine-tuning of lots of physical constants.
Yeah.
And what's the explanation for that? Why do we have a universe where the law of gravity and the nature of space-time is just suited for evolution to occur?
Oh, it's luck, I think, probably. Just random chance or something like that. You know, look, I'm going to concede something. When I say science can explain everything, I'm not saying that every question is a scientific question. I mean, when science ends, there's still stuff left over. And, you know, there's ethics, there's what's good and bad, how should I live my life? So science doesn't do everything there is to do.
This is good, Ken. We've been at it for 2 minutes, and you're already conceded a lot. You're no longer a simple-minded scientist.
Scientist
or whatever, scientistic person. A scientist is a person who does science. A scientistic person is a person who believes that science answers all questions. And Ken, you've heard the conversion of Ken from a scientistic person to a more well-rounded philosopher. But we're going to hear now from someone who is a scientist but believes there's a lot more in the universe than science thinks of. Listen to the piece from Amy Standen, our roving philosophical reporter, and you'll know what I mean, Ken.
Ask anyone who's devoted his life to a single pursuit, and there's usually a story behind it. This is Bob Russells.
I was always just fascinated with science. Got a telescope when I was a kid, a Bosch and Lomb spotterscope, and saw Saturn the first night and called Dad outside and said, look, that's Saturn. And he said, oh, no, it can't be Saturn. You know, you're just beginning. I said, no, it's Saturn. Take a look. And it was Saturn. It was cool. So I was always very at home in nature. I knew the planets backwards when I was a kid. I used to tell people the names of them in reverse order.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.